Praise the Lord. At the start of this talk, I just want to say that I was secretary to Father Fio. And having worked with him, I think I learned a lot, not only from him, but I functioned with four other chairpersons of the National Service Team. Father Gino, Father Tamburaj, Father Fio, and even Cyril John. And I learned so much from all these leaders. And so today, I'm here to substitute Father Fio as his secretary. Past. Yeah. So let us just sign ourselves with the sign of the cross and asking our Lord to be with us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The topic given to Father Fio was Galatians 3:3. Having begun with the Spirit, are you ending with the flesh? Now, we have been hearing a little about this from the talk given by Cyril. Also, you would have imbibed a little from what was shared by our dear guest, Brother Jim Murphy. And so, Father has given a lot of matter for us to reflect, not for our personal lives, but concerning Catholic charismatic renewal and as leaders. So the first thing in the talk that he says is, how can we apply this text to CCR in India? And he feels that he should start by comparing CCR of bygone days with CCR of today. And now I quote a few things from his written text. In the early days, the CCR was a gushing fountain of new life in the Spirit, which made its mark felt very strongly in the church. St. John Paul II testified to us leaders at the Rome International Conference in 92. As you celebrate the 25th anniversary of the beginning of CCR, I willingly join you in giving praise to God for the many fruits which it has borne in the life of the church. The emergence of the CCR following the Second Vatican Council was a particular gift of the Holy Spirit to the church. And he also quotes at an earlier gathering of leaders in 1987, Father Fio introduced the leaders to the Pope at that meeting, and this is what he addressed to the leaders. The vigor and fruitfulness of the CCR certainly attest to the powerful presence of the Holy Spirit at work in the church after the Second Vatican Council. Because of the Spirit, the church preserves a continual youthful vitality, and the CCR is an eloquent manifestation of this vitality. So in the first place here, we have to acknowledge that CCR is a gift of God used for revitalizing the church, giving the church vibrancy and vitality. Now he says, what would he say of today's CCR? And this, he says the best way to tell you what's happening in CCR today is to quote from a letter sent to him by a leader of a neighboring country. This is what the leader wrote. Dear Father, the charismatic prayer group that I am committed to was established in the mid-70s and has been operating continuously since 1986. We've had our ups and downs. There are about 40 people coming to the weekly prayer meetings. However, we are struggling these days with leaders and members needing to remain on fire by the Holy Spirit. We have had formations, but the spiritual level of the group seems to have stagnated. The majority of the core team have served for more than 25 years, their Jubilee. And we have difficulty finding people to step forward to serve. Are things very different, Father Fio asks. Father Fio says, I get feedback from groups in Mumbai, even London, and wherever I go, wherever I'm invited to speak. Obviously, there are good things happening in the CCR today, and Pope Francis is still encouraging the CCR to play its role in the church. But this grand conference in Goa is looking at the text in Galatians 3:3. Having started in the spirit, are you now ending in the flesh and asking how it can inspire us? Excuse me. So the very first point that he raises here is about leadership formation. He says it is an absolute essential, and I want to quote some of the things that he has written. And I must tell you, with his permission, I said, Father, I can't keep to your text, no doubt. And he said, yes, may I, don't want it to be like a news report. So I told him, with your permission, can I please make a few observations and comments, so which he has agreed. So I will do this in between. What are some of the reasons for the stagnation or ending in the flesh? This is such a beautiful quote from St. John Paul II again. I think Father Fio had a very special regard for him, because when he was at the ICRIS office, which was first known as ICRO, he was very much in touch with Pope John Paul II, who is now a saint. So what does the Pope say? Real openness to the Holy Spirit, as he vivifies and guides the church, helps you to live in union with the Lord Jesus. This, I must say, when the Pope says in union with the Lord Jesus, we are reminded of two things that Jesus has clearly told us in John chapter 15. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And then he says, remain in me, abide in me. And this is the union that our Pope is speaking about. And he says, this union, it is your strength and your special treasure. All of us know how much Jesus has done for us and how much we treasure this union with him. And you are striving to exercise it in various ways. But this gift from God, he's talking about the charismatic renewal, this gift from God is also a fragile treasure and one which you must take special care of. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So we have to take special care of this gift, this grace given to us by God of the Catholic charismatic renewal. How? And now he goes on to say, the success of the CCR depends to a great extent on an informed, balanced, and doctrinally sound leadership, especially at the local level. Already in 1997, the Silver Jubilee of Charismatic Renewal in India, when I was NSD chairman for the second time, I wrote a handbook for leaders, in which I said leadership was the most pressing problem facing the renewal. I repeat, leadership was the most pressing problem facing the renewal. And he quotes, some leaders do not have the doctrinal and scriptural formation which would give them a firm hold on their Catholic identity. Some lack the basic skills of leading a prayer meeting. A few are also psychologically immature, resulting in wrong emphases and aberrations like emotionalism, signs and wonders. seeing evil spirits everywhere, elitism, and let me make a small digression here. Now, while he makes the digression there, I want to just tell you some of the things that I have observed. And I must say, when I have observed, I've been part of the leadership, especially in Bangalore. Formation, dear brothers and sisters, is imperative. God wants us to care for the people that he has given us. As Father has already mentioned earlier, our relationship with the Lord is of importance, and I'll be touching more about it a little later. But what I say, first things first, are we looking up to other leaders for our formation, or are we looking up to God? In Wisdom chapter 9, it says very clearly, even the most perfect of men, without the wisdom that comes from you, he will be regarded as nothing. That's such a beautiful text in Wisdom chapter 9. I would ask you to read it in your spare time today. Wisdom chapter 9, verses 1 to 12. And ultimately, the writer here, Solomon, says that wisdom will be with us and toil with us for the glory of God. Praise the Lord. So wisdom is needed. That is why we find King Solomon, when he had that dream, the Lord appeared to him in his dream. What did he ask for? He asked for wisdom. And then, for what? I will read to you from 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 9. This is the reason why he asked for wisdom. Give thy servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern thy people, that I may discern between good and evil, for who is able to govern this thy great people? And so we see he's asking for understanding, and he's asking for wisdom in order to discern. Now we know to discern means to sift what is from the Lord and what is from our human nature. This, dear brothers and sisters, I feel sad to say this, is sorely lacking in the charismatic renewal amongst our leaders today. Discernment. In fact, in one particular place when I went and I spoke about it, the chairperson of that place was asking me, what is discernment? And I want to say, soon after Jesus' ascension to heaven, one member of the 12 was missing. Who? Judas. And Peter, in Acts chapter 1, tells the other apostles, his brother apostles, he says to them, the company of persons was about 120, so there are disciples also. Brethren, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas. So whatever happened to Judas was actually spoken of earlier in the scriptures, that he was going to betray the Lord, etc. I'm coming to the last verse, 24. This is chapter 1 of Acts, verse 24. And they prayed and said, Lord, who knows the hearts of all men, show which one of these two thou hast chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place. And so we see that in charismatic renewal, we need this discernment even in the choice of leaders. I find at times that because there are maybe certain things to carry out in the renewal, certain plans to be implemented, leaders are chosen who, as Father Fio has mentioned, are really immature. There's an added reason We as leaders will have people working with us and maybe even under us. Apart from our lives being exemplary, I would say that we have to take this to heart, what the author in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17 says to us. Hebrews 13, 17. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls, as men who will give account. Let them do this joyfully and not sadly, for that would be of no advantage to you. For they are keeping watch over your souls as men who will have to give account to who? Not to the auditor, to God. This is a very serious thing for us leaders, that God is giving us people to nurture them, to nourish them in the faith, to strengthen them, to make them so strong that they will withstand not only the wiles of the enemy, but even what is happening in our country today, to stand up against all the wrong policies of the government, to stand up for truth and justice. So, in this regard of discernment, I not only said in the choice of leaders, but I want to mention two specific incidents while I was serving on the national service team where discernment was needed. This was while Father Thamburaj was the chairman. As secretary, year after year, I was taking down the minutes of the meeting, and funds had been collected to build a national training center, because that was a great need for us at that time. We were moving from place to place. People were finding it very hard to travel, etc. And I looked at Father one day at the meeting and I said, Father, how long more am I going to write this in the minutes? That no decision has been taken. The matter is going to be discussed again at the next meeting. This has gone on for 4 meetings a year for 3 years. So Father said, right, I will take you all through Ignatian discernment. And I can't tell you how beautiful it was, brothers and sisters. He asked us to pray for 30 minutes before the Blessed Sacrament and to come back. And then he asked each one in turn, what has the Lord said to you, or what do you feel now about the National Training Center? The answer was 10 yes and 2 no. And Father said, there's no unanimity, so go back and pray. And I must tell you, this happened 3-4 times. The second time, it was 7 yes, 5 no. I'm cutting a long story short, and finally, it was 12 no. Unanimity, every one of the 12 was present said no to the training center, and those funds were utilized to purchase an office in Bangalore. So I really thank you, Father Thambu, for what you took us through. Praise the Lord. In another case of concerning leadership, we often trade commitment to convenience. And I recall Father Gino telling us leaders that he would take us through a formation program. And when it came to deciding the day and the time, each one was saying, I cannot come, I cannot come. And so Father just told us, all of you will come to the Good Shepherd Convent at 6 a.m. And believe it or not, 40 to 50 leaders were there at 6 sharp in the morning, went through the formation for 10 weeks, the weekends, and at the end of it all, we really have to thank and praise God, because most of those leaders who were formed through Father Gino's formation program are actively involved in the renewal today. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Lord. We bless you. We glorify you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. So this, as I said, brothers and sisters, there's a great need for discernment and also to be formed. Father Fio has specifically spoken about formation, but as I said, we have to depend on the Lord first in the choice of leaders and also in this whole process of discernment. Let me get back to Father Fio's matter now. So after speaking about this, he said that he wanted to go into a small digression, and the digression is his own testimony about leadership, which brings out another very, very vital aspect in leadership. Father says, I was baptized in the Holy Spirit on 11th February 1972, when I was 28 years old. I think that was the time after he was baptized, he went hunting for Luz Maria's and Minu's home. Yes. While alone in a prayer in my room at Vinayalaya, a Jesuit community in Mumbai, God unexpectedly and sovereignly blessed me with a totally undeserved Abba experience. As I knelt in solitary prayer before my vows crucifix, that's a crucifix that he had with him at the time he took his vows, surrendering my broken life to Jesus as Lord, the Father spoke words of affirmation and empowering me, saying, Fio, you are my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. This Abba experience changed my life completely. Most importantly, I was enriched with a new and gratuitous spiritual connection with all three persons of the Blessed Trinity. This amazing grace of infused contemplation endures till today. The familiar blessing of 2 Corinthians 13:13, which we hear every day at the start of the Mass, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, not as theoretical commodities, but as real relationships. God has blessed me with an invincible faith conviction that Christianity is not, first of all, a matter of rules and rituals, but of a network of relationships. I myself realize, brothers and sisters, how, though the mystery of the Blessed Trinity is something we will never be able to comprehend, you can experience each one of them. You can experience the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It is God who always takes the initiative in establishing these personal and intimate relationships with each disciple, to which we must personally respond. I am continuing to learn that it is my ongoing task to cooperate with the Holy Spirit daily to strengthen and deepen these relationships. So many scripture texts have come alive for me since then, especially from the Gospel according to John and from the letters of Paul. I have also realized that a fourth intimate and personal relationship necessarily flows from the first three, that is a relationship with the church, the body of Christ. Praise the Lord. And that John 13:34, Jesus' new commandment of love, is a non-negotiable sign of my Christian identity. From these four fundamental relationships with the Father, the Son, the Spirit, and the Church flow all other human relationships with family, neighbors, friends of whatever creed, and with creation itself. And here again, brothers and sisters, I want to share a little bit about the relationships. All of us, once we have had our Christ experience, I know we are, you know, so caught up with that initial exuberance, But the Lord wants us to grow in that relationship with Him. And for this, I remember Catholic Charismatic Renewal has always advocated. I came into the Charismatic Renewal in 1981. And one of the first things that we were taught is that we must abide in Christ, we must remain in Christ. And so six things were given to us as constants, basics, in order to grow in our relationship with the Lord. I'm mentioning the six to you. They were prayer, the Word of God, the sacraments, ongoing forgiveness, ongoing repentance, and the last one was discipline. And under discipline came these two. One was self-denial, and the other was submission to authority. And I found we never heard anything about charisms, though we used to see all our lovely leaders exercising charisms, praying over people, people getting healed, the marvelous programs that were held. As I said, God has given us these leaders from whom we learn so much. And so, whenever our leaders met us, they would ask us, are you going to the sacraments regularly? Are you reading the Word of God? Do you do 1 hour's personal prayer? I remember telling my leader, 1 hour? I can't even pray 2 minutes and you're asking me to pray for 1 hour. And then, as time went by, 1 hour was not enough. Really. So, as I said, this relationship with the Lord, remaining in Christ, abiding in Christ through these constants, day after day, receiving so much from the Lord, blessed and strengthened us. In fact, our relationship with the Lord has to be the foundation, as Father said, of every other human relationship. Today, why are families crumbling? Why are friendships not lasting? Why are couples breaking up so fast, even after being in love for years together? Simply because this relationship with the Lord, the love of God, is not the basis of their relationships. Father has also mentioned about the church, and I'm not saying too much about it, but one of the things that happens is, if we have had a genuine experience of the Lord in our lives, then you will have a tremendous love for your church. You never, never, ever want to be separated from the church. We begin to realize the richness, the rich heritage of our church, and what the church gives us, no one else can. And that is why Jesus gives us this one commandment of love. Love of God and love of neighbor. Our 10 commandments are based on this. Or Jesus has categorized this, love of God, the first three, love of neighbor, the other 7. The last thing that I want to say is about relationships is, if we just go to Galatians chapter 5:20, we see the works of the flesh there. Now the works of the flesh are plain: fornication, impurity, licentiousness. These three will come under the category of immorality, which Cyril spoke about yesterday. Idolatry. As leaders, our work may become so important to us, brothers and sisters, that it can become an idol in our lives. We become so work-oriented instead of being people-oriented. Then we have sorcery. Fortune telling. Are some of us using our charisms for this? I tell you, brothers and sisters, I feel sad to say this. I can see the lives of young youth destroyed because of wrong messages given to them. It's a sad situation. Young people, I know 2 or 3 in Bangalore, who are broken and emotionally destroyed. Then we come to these, what we think are lesser sins. immorality, oh, very bad. Idolatry is bad. But what about these? Enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, selfishness, dissension, party spirit, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and the like. And the Lord says here, I warn you as I warned you before, that those who do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. These lesser sins are really big sins in the eyes of the Lord, especially when it comes to us leaders. Today you see so much of backbiting. I often tell people when they come and tell me things, are you willing to repeat what you're saying to me in front of the person? And then they make an excuse. No, it's okay. Conflicts that have not been resolved over a period of time have caused serious damage to the charismatic renewal. Well, people get to hear about these things, and then when you invite them for the charismatic meeting, what do they say? No, I don't want to come. You know what's happening over there? Sometimes I hear this in my own home. They'll be discussing about somebody, and they'll say, that too, she's in the charismatic renewal. And what is, I'm quick to defend and say, thank God she's there, or she'd have been 100 times worse. Praise the Lord. You can't help, you know, when you have experienced Jesus, I know we are not going to be holy overnight. But these are some of the things that will happen in our lives. And this is where the need to pray to the Holy Spirit every day, to be obedient to His promptings. He will tell you sometimes, keep quiet. I have a beautiful testimony, but I won't share it now because I need time. So now we go back to Father Fio's text, where after speaking about the importance of his relationships with the Trinity and also with the Church and how it has been helping him to this day, he now next comes to a very positive point saying, what can we do to rejuvenate the Catholic charismatic renewal? And he uses a very important text, a prayer, which comes in the collect of the Mass for Pentecost Sunday, which reads, O God, send forth your Spirit again with the force of a mighty wind to broaden the horizons of our minds, etc. Charismatics sing, let the fire fall. Are we really asking for the broadening of the horizons of our minds? I sometimes tell young people and even adults in the charismatic prayer groups that we should not be concerned all the time with our personal salvation and sanctification. Once you have experienced the Lord, and once we are doing these basic things in our lives, then we have to look beyond. And this is where the broadening of the horizon of our minds comes. What does Father say? Are our formation programs planned to help develop in us the mind of Christ? What formation programs are we all the time organizing besides what you call charism retreats and prophetic intercession retreats? In the early days, my colleagues and I on the NST organized what we called fully Catholic and fully charismatic seminars for leaders and co-group leaders, in which we help the participants to broaden the horizons of their minds. And what does he advocate? He advocates study, which is very essential for us to grow. Not just reading the scriptures. Scriptures is very important, God's word, which must be given priority. But he says, what about the study of papal encyclicals, the letters that come from the Pope at regular intervals? What about the Vatican II documents? I think sometimes in the early days when I just used to see the thick book of the Vatican II documents, I just used to put it aside. But I tell you, there's such a wealth of information in it. All the councils that were working for the revitalization of the Church. And he says, what about Bible-based teachings and biblical spirituality? The other point that he stressed on here, and I'm quoting again, are the same old teachings about charisms and prayer meetings given at week after week to indifferent and bored audiences? And what about scripture study becoming scripture literate in a Catholic way, gaining a real familiarity with the Word of God? He had good reason to write this, becoming scripture literate in a Catholic way, because the influence of so many of these fundamentalists is, I would say, hampering people's growth, not only as leaders, but the contribution that they could give to the people under their care. You can't give to people what you don't have. And today we know that Satan appears as an angel of light. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 14, he appears as an angel of light. And so somebody will say, why don't you come for this Bible study? And you rush there. And believe it or not, your mind is being twisted. A young girl went to her father some time back and said, Daddy, I'm leaving the Catholic Church. Why? Because there's no salvation in the Catholic Church. And you know what the father said to her? If you're leaving the church, you can leave this home right now. But he got round his daughter. He, of course, said this to admonish her a little and scare her a little. He said, where did you hear this? And then she told of how she was invited to a meeting where people had gathered together, and this is the indoctrination that was taking place. There is another viewpoint that sometimes people will say to us, look, I read something in the scriptures and I want to be guided. So if we are helpless ourselves, it shouldn't be like the blind leading the blind, then we tell them, look, you go to so-and-so priest. No, I won't go. He doesn't explain well. But there are numerous priests who are able to explain. We have a block in our minds that he will not be able to convey to us what we want. Fixations in our mind. That sometimes in the charismatic renewal, when we have grown a little bit, we think we know everything. And what that priest is telling me is not what I want to hear. We are warned about itching ears. Paul tells us that this is going to happen to us, that we will have itching ears. We want to hear what we want to hear. So anyway, Father has brought this out as a very important point. He says, have you organized serious study programs of the Bible and biblical spirituality for leaders on a national and local level and for members of your prayer groups? I'm sure in every archdiocese in India, the seminaries usually offer courses for lay people, and we must encourage our lay people to attend these courses. I myself have attended many in St. Peter's Seminary in Bangalore and have benefited very much. Then he says, here is a stirring text from Vatican II's Church in the Modern World. Now, this is apart from the study part that was given to us, that we should build ourselves up and grow through all these. A new civilization of love in obedience to their Lord and in His Spirit. They must develop on earth the values of human dignity, brotherhood, and freedom, and indeed all the good things that come from our nature and our activity. What is meant here is explained by Father. Far from making charismatics Catholic elitists or cliquish, the Spirit rather wants to improve their ability to relate with their peers in the church and in the world. Brothers and sisters, when Jesus gave that great commission in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. This is what Jesus was talking about. That we have to make disciples of all nations, teaching them what he has commanded us. I don't want to get into this aspect of evangelization, but do we raise our voices and talk to people in society, maybe even to our neighbors around our home, sometimes giving them the Christian perspective of certain things that are happening? This is what Father is meaning here, to relate with their peers in the church and in the world. Hence, charismatic Catholics are not to be afraid of, nor out of prejudice or of false religiosity, reject anything that is genuinely human, but taking their cue from the church feel with the church, and convey that with the church, they must involve themselves in every area of human activity. This is what Robin was speaking about yesterday. That I take my Christ experience into the world, into my workplace, wherever I go, even if it's to the marketplace. Do I share with others? Maybe sometimes people are hurting. You see somebody crying. Have you ever gone to reach out to them and say, just put your hand on them? This happened once in the bank. There was a lady in the bank. She and the manager were having such a heated argument. And she was telling him, I've come from so far and you're not giving me, helping me with the work that I have to do. She said, you know, I'm a heart patient. And you know, my heart was breaking for her because I know from where she had come. And when she sat a little away, I slowly went up to her and I said, the manager himself is under pressure, but I want you to be at peace. And immediately she started weeping. I just placed my hand on her and I said, may the peace of Jesus be with you. Following day when I went to the bank on some work, the manager is thanking me and saying, ma'am, I want to thank you. I said, for what? He said, you know, I saw on my screen here, you know, there are the cameras, I saw you placing your hand on that lady and praying with her. This is what the Lord is asking of us. What am I doing with my Christ experience? Am I keeping it for myself and my family and let the rest of the world go by? No, brothers and sisters. This is precisely what Father has brought out very well. He says, to relate with their peers in the church and in the world. Whenever we can, for this reason, we have to join associations in society, maybe even an NGO, where what Jesus has given me, I can take to others. Once there were a lot of communal riots in Bangalore, and the police department were going around home to home asking who will be on the peace committees. They were not going to equip us with guns, I must tell you. But they wanted us just to keep a watchful eye where there was any tension brewing. I joined that peace committee. And at regular intervals, we used to have meetings at the police station. And this is what Jesus is saying. Don't just live for yourself. Don't be working out your personal sanctification and salvation. I want to give of yourself to everyone other. Love your neighbor as yourself. Your neighbor is everyone else other than yourself. Praise the Lord. So the fields of science, he says, culture, arts, politics, business, I know we have gifted musicians, painters, etc., work with other music groups. Of course, I know our musicians here will be very cautious because some of the songs that are sung outside are most unspiritual. Thus, they will be contributing to the fulfillment in history of the divine plan. And thereby, they will themselves personally grow in the spirit. For faith is meant to be shared. Here it comes. Not hoarded. And a lamp is meant to be held aloft, not hidden under a bed. The flame of faith enkindled by the Spirit will grow stronger and brighter as it is shared with many. And each disciple will, again in the words of St. Paul, grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every joint with which it is supplied, when each part is working properly, making bodily growth and upbuilds itself in love. That quotation is from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15. So, talking about growth, growing up in every way into him who is the head, Jesus Christ. Colossians 1:18 says very clearly, he is the head of the body. And I feel sometimes we are so lost with our own desire for spirituality that we forget that there are other members of the body of Christ in my parish, in my local churches, who need to also experience Jesus as their head. I just put a point here. This is the next point. I'll just share the next one also. Now, Father Fio goes on to give us the vision for the next 50 years. I surely won't be there. Yeah, but anyway, I'll probably celebrate from elsewhere. He says, let me therefore suggest another more appropriate text for our vision for the next 50 years. And he's taken this from Romans chapter 12:11, be aglow with the Spirit. Now, if you look at the theme of the convention, rekindle the fire. If that fire is rekindled in us at this conference, surely you will be aglow with the Spirit. When you go back, people are going to ask, where did you go? Where were you? You're looking so different. Ah, your face is glowing. What's on the inside is happening on the outside. Praise the Lord. Be aglow with the Spirit, he says. These words, St. Paul is writing these words to today's CCR as well. Because the letter to the Romans was written to the early charismatic Christians. How do we know this? Because especially chapter 8 of Romans is a splendid description of the work of the Holy Spirit in us. Please read this chapter in your free time. Romans chapter 8. You also please read Romans chapter 5. Both these concerning the flesh and the spirit. We apply it to our personal lives as we read, but it is very applicable also for us as leaders and what is happening in Catholic Charismatic Renewal. How do we know this, he says, because especially chapter 8 of Romans is a splendid description of the work of the Holy Spirit in us. In fact, Romans 8:13 is such a beautiful text. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead. Yes, sorry, 11. Romans chapter 8, verse 11. Did I say 13? Yeah, okay. He will renew our mortal bodies with the very life that comes from God. I'll read that text. Let me give it to you as it's given here. Romans 8, 11. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies. We are made up of body, mind, and spirit. How much we do for our bodies and minds, brothers and sisters. Today I know of parents who will nourish the bodies of their children to see that they are strong and healthy. They'll see that they achieve much with all the degrees that they have because we're living in a very competitive world. But what about the spirit? So when we, now let me not point fingers. What was I? Until I received the baptism in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit who was dormant in my life from the time of my baptism suddenly seemed to burst forth in my life. And I tell you, my experience was such a dramatic one that many of my family's members were shocked. Till today, my sister says, you know, knowing the type of person you were, a woman of the world, I can't believe that you are standing before people with a Bible in your hand. Praise the Lord. Not my work, the work of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Okay, so let's get back to this now. Within, where did I stop? Notice, however, that Romans is not about charismatic work of the Spirit in a Christian, but Romans, that chapter, is about character building of the Spirit who works interiorly within each Christian spirit and psyche. Within our spirit, God's Spirit is making us reborn sons and daughters of God and co-heirs with Christ. And within our psyche or mind, God's Spirit is trying to form a truly Christ-like character or personality in each of us. This is even more necessary for today's new evangelization than, he says, external charisms. Now, Father Fio explains a little bit about this need for character formation. Character formation was a major part of the Spirit's activity, first of all, in Jesus. Now, why does he say in Jesus? As I was reading through, I got it. Jesus was 100% God and 100% human. And as man, he needed this character formation, guided by the Spirit, to know when to speak, when not to speak. How much we need that also, huh? When to speak and when not to speak. There were times when he displayed righteous anger. Who can think of Jesus, meek and humble of heart, taking a whip, driving out the people from the temple who were selling things, not keeping the temple as a house of prayer? Character formation was a major part of the Spirit's activity, first of all in Jesus, and then in those of his disciples, whom we call the saints. For God wants every co-heir with Christ to grow to maturity, to the measure and full stature of Christ. The quotation is from Ephesians 4:13. This means that charismatic disciples must not only be known for their zeal and piety, but even more for their authentic Christ-like character. Now, I'm going a little faster here. When Father Fio expresses this about character of every Christian disciple, he mentions six strengths. And he said every psychologist will look for these in a person because they are called character strengths. What are they? Open-mindedness, needed especially at our leadership meetings. Open-mindedness. We should never come with our agenda in mind and enforce that on others. When we are open-minded, what you have thought was right and proper may not be the thing God wants. First one, open-mindedness. Second is courage. You know, the courage to speak out. I know at every service team, whichever service team you belong to, or even for you're on the core team of a prayer group, it is important for us to contribute by speaking out. Very often what happens at our big meetings is the people will speak outside the meeting. That's not good. Speak in the meeting. We can agree to disagree, and we can also disagree to agree. The next one mentioned is the capacity to love. Sometimes we may come across fellow leaders whom we can't hit it off with. But I tell you, God has purposely put us in that group to help us to grow, to accept that person, and to accept them in love, and to be loved. Teamwork. This is something that Jesus had always planned. That's why he sent his disciples out two by two. It's important for us as leaders to work in a team when we are training others, whether it's for charisms or for any workshop that we're having, we are training them to work in a team. When we go on outreaches to people, always go together with two or three others. I say this sometimes, that as leaders we can keep one another on the right track. We may say or do things which are not in keeping with what Jesus wants. The next one is prudence. Prudence is something very, very essential. There are times when we have to withhold the truth. I remember once at a retreat, a lady came and asked me, she said, you know, this is happening, but there's some altercation going on in my home, and my mother-in-law is insisting that I tell her what her daughter spoke to me. I told my mother, she never said anything, is that a lie? I asked her, why did you say this to your mother? She said, I wanted it for the sake of peace. This is prudence, where you withhold the truth sometimes in order to work towards peace, love, and unity. And then the last one he mentions is authentic spirituality. I'll go a little faster now. He identifies these six character strengths with the fruit of the Spirit given in Galatians 5:22. The main one being love, and all the other eight, I would say like they are offshoots of love. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. These fruit of the Holy Spirit are actually the character traits of Jesus Christ. And this should be our goal in our personal lives, that we have to strive to becoming like Jesus. I always say sometimes how we beautifully sing in church to be like Jesus. Really, we want to be like him. There was a young boy who had written on his arm, WWJD, to remind himself, what would Jesus do? I had a situation in my home where I put that question to myself, what would Jesus do? It was a situation where I could condemn or accept the person for who and what they were and what they had said and done. So this is very important, that I must strive to be like Jesus. And so for us, if we want to grow in the character of Jesus, we have to ask ourselves from time to time, which of these character traits am I lacking in? A week after I came into the Charismatic Renewal, I got down on my knees and I said, Lord, I'm the most impatient person on the face of this earth. Please forgive me for all the, you know, hurt I have caused people by my impatience. And I must tell you, brothers and sisters, the beautiful way in which the Spirit will convict you, telling you to hold back words, telling you to relax, telling you not to get flustered, angry, bitter. And this ultimately leads to impatience, where you get impatient with people, you get irritable with people. Looking back now, 36 years in Charismatic Renewal, I can honestly say, Lord, thank you. I have grown 85 to 90% in patience. Praise the Lord. Even when provoked. And so from time to time, ask ourselves, when you're sitting in the chapel, which of these fruit of the Spirit am I lacking in? Now I said this is our goal, to be like Jesus. This is not wishful thinking. In Romans 8:29, very clearly, it is the Father's desire that we are conformed to the image of His Son. This is regaining the lost image, the image that was lost in the Garden of Eden, the original sin that has caught up with us when we are born. And so we have to regain that lost image. It is the Father's desire that we are conformed to the image of His Son. Who is going to help? The Holy Spirit. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being changed into His likeness from one degree of glory to another, for this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. The text is 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18. So the Holy Spirit plays a major role in helping to transform us and make us like Jesus. I sometimes use this little practical example to show people. Very often people think that when I have had my Christ experience, I'm a new creation. Wow, now there's, you know, no problem, no conflict with the flesh and the spirit. But I tell you, the old nature is very much over there. And this is why we find sometimes the conflict going on inside of us. Do I tell the truth? Do I tell a lie? Do I shut my mouth or do I keep quiet? The conflict goes on all the time. But as the Spirit is going to transform us, transform that nature, that old sinful nature of ours, into the very nature of Jesus Christ. So if this is your, I use this sometimes in the prayer meetings, the divine nature of Jesus Christ. This is my human nature, rebellious human nature. What does the Holy Spirit do? I have to cooperate with Him, listen to His promptings, and little by little, this is what happens. My human nature is being transformed into the divine nature. I'm not going to ask any of you, but if I ask myself, how much have I grown like Jesus after so many years? I sometimes say, maybe about 35-40%, and I better pull up my socks because there's not much time left. Yeah. So this is